in this last lecture of the module, we look at our role in the history of life. Humans are mammals, and mammals are one group of organisms that managed to survive the KT extinction. As we've seen, and as everyone knows, the dinosaurs and many of the large reptiles and lizards did not survive the KT extinction and the geological or impact that caused it. Mammals could burrow underground and escape the harsh surface conditions, and their omnivorous diet meant they could continue to find food. These survivors would diversify into the predecessors of all modern mammals. Primates are mammals that evolved an arboreal life, which is to say a life lived in trees and using plants as a food source. They first appear in the fossil record during the Paleocene era, about 66 to 56 million years ago. These first primates are much smaller than present-day primates. They're similar to squirrels or tree shrews in size and appearance. The beginning of the Eocene epoch, which was 56 million to 34 million years ago, coincides with the emergence of the early forms of placental mammal orders that are present today. In addition, placental mammals with larger bodies and bigger brains began to appear in the fossil record at this time, including some mammals that are much larger than any present-day mammals on the Earth. The first human ancestor appears in the fossil primate record between 5 and 7 million years ago. So here we see the tree of life going back in schematic form to our ancestral primate 60 million years ago, soon after the KT impact, and gradually evolution and diversification through the prosimians, the monkeys, the apes, and then humans. Fossils can be used to indicate the manner of this evolution, such as the point at which prehumans started to walk upright and their evolution in brain size from the size of the skull casing in the fossils. Upright walking is identified by the position of the hole in the skull for the spine. We can see here the schematic view of the evolution from ancestral primates 60 million years ago, just after the KT impact, through the diversification of prosimians, monkeys, apes, and then eventually humans and modern prehumans. The progression to bipedalism, the evolution of brains, did not occur completely smoothly and linear. There were lurches in evolution and accelerated times of evolution. And you can also see that there are three distinct species of humans that coexisted as recently as 200,000 years ago. So human evolution, looking backwards, is not a single linear path that ends up inevitably and inexorably with us. There's diversification and experimentation, culling by natural selection, occurring throughout pre-human history. The most recent diversification and branching occurs with Neanderthal humans, who lived in Europe and Eurasia between 400,000 and 40,000 years ago. They were fully our rivals, with bigger brains, stockier, and actually better adapted to the cold climate through much of this time. Neanderthals shared Europe with Homo sapiens for at least 5,000 years, and perhaps far longer. They apparently died out a few thousand years after modern humans migrated out of Africa. And we can see that 1.5 to 2% of the present genome is from non-African DNA, indicating Neanderthal. It looks like there was genetic mixing between these two pre-human species. 20% of the Neanderthal genome is actually preserved in the current day human population. Stephen Hawking has said, intelligence is the ability to adapt to change. And so we can see in this evolutionary path some of the landmarks in the evolution of pre-humans in terms of their ability to adapt to and survive in a changing environment. The use of stone tools dates back to 2 or 2.5 million years ago. A fundamental change occurred with the control of fire. There's evidence that prehumans were able to harness naturally occurring fires, but they were not able to sustain them. The ability to start fire arbitrarily and cook meat and other food and control fire was a landmark in human evolution. There's evidence that about 500,000 years ago, humans were operating in bands to hunt in a group to gain larger control over their resources. And there's evidence both in the fossil record and in the shape of the brain for evolution of spoken language about 300,000 years ago. Various other landmarks include the first art, a clear sign that humans had abstract capability of thinking other than for their own survival. Probably the earliest forms of art date from the Blombos Caves in southern Africa about 80,000 years ago. And by 20, 30, and 40,000 years ago, we find cave paintings throughout Europe. The very beginnings of the rudiments of written language occur about 80,000 years ago. And if you go to 40,000 years ago, we have musical instruments, more complex adornments of humans with decorations and jewelry, funereal artifacts, and the rudiments of human culture starting to emerge, all at a time long before any fixed civilizations. All of these pre-humans or early humans were nomads, living at this point in small bands and surviving by their wits and moving from place to place to follow the food sources. In thinking about our place in the story of life, and more intriguingly, in thinking about the possibility of what might be out there in the universe, a key attribute of our form of life is intelligence. We would love to know whether species exist elsewhere in the universe and whether some of them have become intelligent. But what do we mean by intelligence? It can be as hard to define this word as it is for biologists to define life itself. We might go to an encyclopedia definition, which declares intelligence to be the ability to adapt effectively to the environment, either by making a change in oneself or by changing the environment or finding a new one. Intelligence is not a single mental process, but rather a combination of many mental processes directed towards effective adaptation to the environment. So viewed at in these terms, intelligence is an accelerant to the process of natural selection itself, which is the purely genetic adaptation to the environment by natural selection. With intelligence, we can accelerate this process, essentially exempt ourselves from the process of natural selection that other animals are subject to. Intelligence is not exclusively the domain of humans. There are gradations of intelligence. Social insects, for example, have complex behavior, highly specialized function. They communicate by chemical means. The chemical signaling using pheromones of some insects and animals corresponds to the same bit rate as human verbal communication. So this is not a trivial amount of information being passed between organisms. Intelligent function in social insects is distributed within the colony or the hive rather than in the individuals. This is a different architecture for intelligence. And while we might not pretend that social insects are as smart as we are, they're organized in different ways. And a maybe more interesting question is what might social insects evolve into given another 100 million years to evolve? Going up the food chain and up to higher organisms, there are birds with formerly quite small brains where neuroscientists have said the wiring and the density of organization within those brains is quite compact and dense. These are very efficient small brains. Crows, for example, and other corvids have been known to craft and use tools and display fairly complex problem-solving skills. We're confident we're the most intelligent creatures on planet Earth, but it's worth considering other forms of life we share the planet with, because they may be indicative of the kinds of intelligence we might find out in the universe. Dolphins are a good example. They're marine mammals. They have highly complex social lives. They have language. And if you watch this video, you'll have to believe that they have some level of intelligence to be so creatively playful. Thank you. for another example of high intelligence in a creature far removed from us, humans and octopuses separated in the tree of life 400 million years ago. These creatures have distributed brains, a part of their central processing unit distributed to each of their arms. And in their extraordinary displays of camouflage, both for predation and for protecting from predation, they display the incredible capability of not only simulating the color and texture of a surface, but also its rugosity or roughness. Watch the octopus. If we move up to much closer ancestors to ours, the apes, the gorillas, and the chimpanzees, we have clear signs of intelligence and the use of language. Coco the gorilla, for example, would paint prolifically and once painted a bird and then used sign language to communicate that she had painted a bird. Orangutans use leaves to lower the warning sound they emit, making themselves sound larger to predators. Other examples of fairly intelligent species whose intelligence we simply don't know how to characterize, but in whom we see complex behavior, are marine mammals, orcas, dolphins. There are social functions of these creatures. They use language not fully understood by us, and they clearly have some forms of intelligence that are non-trivial. The best way to characterize intelligence amongst creatures where we try to compare them is the encephalization quotient, or EQ, which is the ratio of the brain mass to the body mass. In these terms, humans do indeed have the highest ratio, around 7.5, but freshwater dolphins have almost as high a ratio, 4.5. Dogs, meanwhile, are down near 1 in these terms. So EQ, intelligence encephalization quotient, does trend positively with intelligence. If we look at our ancestors and their evolution, we can see that the brain volume underwent two surges going back to pre-human ancestors 3 million years ago. There was a gradual evolution, then a doubling of brain size somewhere between 500,000 and 1 million years ago, and then a final growth by 50% in brain size in the last few 100,000 years, which also corresponded to the rudiments of technology use among early humans and human culture appearing for the first time. This late surge in evolution drove up the ratio of brain mass to body mass and corresponds to the higher levels of intelligence that we believe mark us out as unique on the Earth. So we can ask the question, how common is intelligence on this planet? We could say that hundreds of millions of species have evolved over 2.5 billion years since the first cells, and several species or types of humans have evolved in a tiny fraction of that time, less than 0.1%, several hundred thousand or a million years. And of those, only one species survived. Only one of these species, Homo sapiens sapiens, our species, of all these millions of organisms, has demonstrated the ability to solve complex problems and abstract thought. Until we contact another intelligent civilization or another intelligent species evolves on the Earth, we can only guess at how common complex intelligence is in the universe. We are seeking other life in the universe that has made these advances, the ones we have made in the recent past, and in particular species that know their place in the universe and have the same awe and wonder that we do for the incredible universe they occupy. To use the words of Carl Sagan, Imagination will often carry us to worlds that never were, but without it, we go nowhere. Intelligence is a key ingredient in the evolution of life that we believe is special to us. But if we look more generously at life on Earth, we can recognize levels of intelligence in other creatures. The intelligence and communication and organization of social insects, the ability of birds to solve problems and use tools, and the ability of some of our ape cousins to use abstract thought and creativity similar to that of humans. In terms of ratio of brain mass to body mass, humans are indeed special, but not unique. Some marine mammals, whose inner lives we simply don't understand, have very high levels of intelligence. So, intelligence is a key attribute of life that emerged recently and late in a 4 billion year history, and we're left wondering how common intelligence might be in the universe.